Good morning from Banjara Academy. Welcome you all. This is our classroom and I would like to show you. We're doing this session after a long, long time. And as you can see, these are the boards of our students. These are the teams that we make and all the students kind of, you know, show their creativity. As you can see, we have maintained social distancing and with masks and everything, and we are ready to go. So please come, welcome you all. Welcome, good morning.
Good morning.
So nice of you to come here for our classroom session. And today we will be doing a classroom session as well as we'll be going live on Facebook. So every Saturdays we go live, as you all know, and hundreds of people from across the globe, they come and log in, and we take up one aspect of human psychology, and Dr. Ali takes us through, you know, things like relationship, things like career guidance for, you know, students who have just done their 10th standard and who want to know what their aptitude interest lies. So we do that, and many sessions we've done. So we've been going live for the last couple of months, and we plan to do that in the future also. And today we are going to be covering a very, very interesting topic on teenagers, right? And as you can see, the board, this has been done by Meera, one of my colleagues. And teenage is a very fun age. You know, one can enjoy along with them. Yes, there is a strife, there is, you know, they have their own, you know, issues. But then they are fun people to be with. So in today's session, we will be going live. Dr. Ali will be taking us through the topic, living happily with teenagers, right? And also next week, next Saturday, we will be discussing another interesting topic on careers. At any age, you can change your career choices at any stage of your life. So that's also something, actually, now when people are coming for the course admission, we are realizing that many are using this time during the lockdown to introspect and think whether they really, you know, are happy in the career that they are in, or would they like to relook at things and kind of change, you know, the course. So we will be discussing that next Saturday. We'll be going live again on the career choices. So we can show our audience also, and as you know, can maintain. Hi everybody.
Hi.
Welcome you all. Thank you so much for taking our time to come today. And we'll
very
go through.
Nervous.
Sorry?
Are we very nervous?
He'll come. They'll be there. We are maintaining social distancing, so we have enrolled and kept it restricted to about 30 people.
And you are so the courageous ones.
Yes.
Who has
come forward.
Yes. We have not come forward today.
We have to come forward.
Yes. So thank you so much for coming, and of course, next month, you know, as per the government directives, we'll be starting off with our regular classroom sessions. This classroom is usually bustling with activity, you know, so it's very rare that we see such a quiet class, and, you know, over the last, but yeah, we are going to be enjoying ourselves again. So, welcome you all once again. And today, as I told you, we will be discussing on living happily with teenagers. And taking us through this beautiful journey is Dr. Ali Khwaja, and he will be, you know, you can ask any, so once the discussion is, you know, for the next half an hour, he will be discussing the various aspects of teenagers, and then you can ask your questions. So similarly, the live audience, as usual, can ask their questions. So we'll be sitting here, and we can, you know, pose the questions to Dr. Ali, and he will be answering to that. So it will be a very interactive class. We'll be giving you also, the audience here, we'll be giving you a paper and a pencil. Anything that comes to your mind about teenagers, your thoughts, you can put it there, and we'll be collecting it, and we can take it up in today's session. So please feel free to write, ask questions, and we'll take it up. And for the live audience, thank you so much every Saturday for coming, spending time, taking our time to come and attend our sessions, and we will continue to do so in the next few Saturdays as well. So hope you all have a good time, and please interact
with us. So
in fact, you can check who all have come live and I'll give this to them.
Right, then this is our director of programs, Purnima. So
good morning.
Purnima will also be part of this discussion. So we'll get started in another minute, 11 o'clock. We stick to our timings from 11 to 12. So that is when. And a lot of people wait for this program. In fact, many of them ask us to conduct program on various aspects of, you know, human psychology. Also the fact that, you know, we're getting, people are using this time to introspect, to look at life with a new vision. So we are getting a lot of, you know, requests from people to take up a particular topic. Also, so every Saturday we look into the audience requirement also, and we take up one topic after the other. So hope you all have a good time and enjoy the program. And I will now request Dr. Ali to come and start the program. Please, Ali.
Very good morning. The topic, I purposely kept it as living happily with teenagers. Normally we use the word adolescence to talk about that phase of life when no longer a child and not yet an adult. But my experience has been a little different. Why I'm not using the word adolescent is because the onset of adolescence is a biological phenomenon. When a child comes of age, puberty, menarche, we say, okay, this child is now converted into an adolescent. And there changes come in. Not only the physiological changes, but also the emotional changes, behavioral changes. But the very interesting thing, and this I have been asking people for the last 20, 30 years, we all know the onset of adolescence, and normally it coincides with teenage. So by the time the child is getting ready to enter teenage, 11, 12, 13, that's the time when the puberty takes place and the adolescence starts off. So it is a physiological, biological phenomenon, and we know when it happens. But I have been asking this question to a lot of people. When does adolescence end? Does it end when your teenage gets over? Will you say that till you are 19 you are an adolescent, and on your 20th birthday you are no longer an adolescent? No. You'll be surprised in our DCS classes, when we are talking about adolescence, and we start describing that these are the behavior patterns, or this is how adolescents behave. And we go on describing that adolescents have this type of behavior, that type of behavior. And if you do happen to have a child who is an adolescent, you would be experiencing that type of behavior. Some of the ladies in the batch, they raise up their hand and say, I don't know whether you're talking about my teenage son, but I'm getting the feeling you're talking about my husband. That's a type of behavior. So that is one very important issue which I am going to take up today. That the end of adolescence is not a time-bound thing. It's not even a physiological thing. It's a mental thing. When a person feels that I'm no longer an adolescent, I have now moved on to adult life, take the responsibilities and start behaving like an adult. How does that happen? We'll come to that in a minute. To start with, why I specifically said living happily, is because somewhere along the line I have noticed that the word that comes very often with adolescent is problems. Adolescent problems, adolescence problems, that sort of thing. People seem to take it for granted that adolescents are problematic. When my child was small, he was such a gem, he was an angel. He used to listen to everything that I said. He used to be so nice and so well behaved and this and that. People that, now look at him, the way he talks to me, look at his behavior. So we tend to put an upset with problem. But in all these years of experience, let me tell you, adolescents have only one problem, and that is adults. If all the adults disappear from the face of earth, adolescents will live happily ever after. In fact, I still remember long back, there was this huge conference of social workers from all over India, and in a big auditorium, and they had asked me to take a session on these adolescent issues and the behavior of adolescents and things of that sort. So I enter from the back, there's this huge auditorium with the ramp going down, and then there was a stage, and behind that they had put up a banner, Adolescent Behavior by Dr. Ali Khwaja. I said, it's a little too late for me to behave like an adolescent, but I think you have raised a point over there that just because I'm no longer a teenager doesn't mean that I have crossed over the adolescent and my behavior is that of an adult. It is not assured. So when we talk about living happily with the teenagers and making our lives enriched, as adults making our lives enriched, if and when we have the good fortune of having a teenager in our life, in whatever form, it may be your child, it may be your sibling, it may be a neighbor, it may be a friend, whatever it is. But when there is a teenager or many teenagers in your life, how you can actually make your life happy, and that is something which I have actually experienced year after year, decade after decade. But there's a small hitch over there which prevents us from being happy. That is where we get stuck. So, quickly I will run you through this thing called adolescent. Many of you are aware of it, but it will be a quick revision. What is this phase of adolescence? As I told you, it starts off when there is an activation of the hormones. So, you know that this child has come to puberty, anarchy, whatever. In girls, it is very, very obvious when the menstruation starts. So, you say, now this child has become an adolescent. In boys also, you will see certain very physiological changes. Suddenly, his height will shoot up, his shoulders will broaden, his voice will crack, he'll get facial hair, he'll start getting erections. So we know that, okay, this child has now become an adolescent. So that's how the onset of adolescence, which normally, as I said, coincides with teenage. That's why we say teenagers, adolescents, we use those words interchangeably. Now what happens? This is the first time in the life of a child that he or she starts looking for an identity. Who am I? Till the child has got hormones activated and got into this phase of adolescence, the child is very happy to be told that I am my parents' child. I am a student of what B standards and you are done at school and something of that sort. What are your hobbies? I like to play cricket. And what do you want to be? When I grow up, I want to become a doctor and find a cure for cancer. The children learn that very early, They know that if they say things like that, then parents will be very happy and probably they will say, my child is going to become a doctor. There will be no interest in becoming a doctor. But he knows that these are the correct answers. So life goes on very smoothly. Till this adolescence factor comes in. The moment the child moves into adolescence, he starts asking himself, what do I really want to be? What is my goal in life? Where am I headed? Where do you think I'm going to be? And things like that start. So what are these questions that come into a teenager or an adolescent's life? They are primarily three, there are many of them, but these three dominate over everything. The first is relationships. The relationships change. Up till now, whatever daddy was telling was the gospel truth. My daddy, he knows everything in the whole world. When he becomes an adolescent, if daddy says something, daddy is saying it, so maybe I should check what the real truth is. Stupid daddy, he doesn't know, he's outdated, he doesn't know what is happening. Same thing with mother, brother, sister, friends, peer groups, as we say, this is an age of peer influence and things of that sort. So all relationships start changing. And the person wants to know what redefined relationships. The child starts telling the parents are not a small child. Allow me to do what I want. Don't treat me like a small child. Give me some independence. With siblings, this boy has a sister and he said, Chichi, you are a girl, you keep away, don't come and be with my friends. I want to do this. Then as I said, it is the peer age, so you want to belong to a particular gang or a group or something of that sort. So I'm trying to redefine my relationship and look at my identity in terms of relationships. That is the first. The second one is my identity in terms of studies, career, etc. Okay, every year I was told to study, I kept studying, I came up to high school now. They're only going on adding subjects. When I finished with arithmetic, they added algebra. When I finished algebra, they added geometry. When I could graph geometry, they added trigonometry. Where is this whole thing going to end? Why am I studying all these subjects? Where are they leading to? And by now, I also know if people say, if you study hard, you can, you know, get a good job, you can make a lot of money, and then you can have all the luxuries and these and that. I had read somewhere else that Dhirubhai Ambani dropped out of his standard and he became the richest man in India. So what are you trying to tell me that, you know, studying hard gets you more money, is it? Don't try to bluff me in that. These are the type of questions that start coming in. And similarly about careers. Yeah, at one time, you know, everybody said doctor, 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 so I also wanted to. When I saw a cousin of mine is studying medicine, when I saw her textbooks, I could do weightlifting with those textbooks. Man, Papa, this is not what I'm going to do. I don't want to be a doctor. Okay, I don't want to be a doctor, but what do I want to be? Given a chance, I would be a Formula One car racing driver. How do you like the idea? Parents blow their top. So one parent starts off on that. So all these questions and doubts about my identity in terms of studies, academics, performance, entrance exams, coaching, what courses I'm going to take up, and where am I eventually going to land up? I don't even know where I'm going to land up, whether I will get into that IIT and these and all those type of things, or where will I land up? That is the second. First was relationships. The second was academics and careers. The third area in which the teenager is looking for an identity is something which we don't want to talk about, but which actually defines adolescence, that is sexuality. And I'm talking about sexuality, I'm not talking about sex. We have not yet learned to differentiate between the two. A girl who suddenly realizes that there is a neighboring boy who's a hot guy, and he looks so smart and this and that, so when I step out, he is eventually there near the gate. So I should now dress up a little better, you know, so that I impress him. That is sexuality. She's not having sex with the boy, but there's a sexuality involved in it. I even mentioned the boy who tells his sister, you don't come when my friends are here. You don't even sit in the same room and watch TV when my friends come. The sister is puzzled, why, what's the problem? You, your friend, what have I got to do with it? But he has become aware of his sexuality. He knows that when he went to his friend's house and he saw his pretty sister, how he was ogling at her. So he knows now that my friend will come and stare at my sister. He doesn't have the ability to say all that. But that becomes part of his life. What is the sexuality? What does it mean to be a boy or girl? What are boy-girl relationships? What is marriage? What is love affairs? What is all these type of things? This is the third area. So, while they are going through this turmoil and trying to find an identity, if we as adults become part of that searching process, you will see wonders will happen. We can go back to becoming a teenager once again and relive our life through that process of finding an identity. We don't have anything at risk. I have my relationships worked out by now, hopefully. I have my career worked out by now, again, hopefully. And of course, I have understood my sexuality, I am married, I have a sexual partner, I have the that, whatever it is, fine, fine. But today, if I go back to the teenager and learn to live happily with the teenager, you will see that, you know, I can enjoy life and I can make life very happy for them. They actually shot small little video, but it's as usual. Technology is not as good as human beings, so it is refusing to come on, right? If it gets right, we'll show you a quick little video of two teenagers talking to each other. asking a very simple question to all adults in the whole world. Why don't you listen to us? Why don't you give us a chance to actually express what I want to say? You'll be amazed how many of us as adults, without realizing it, do not listen to our teenagers. Whoever they may be, you may be a teacher dealing with teenage students, you may be a parent, you may be anything. But when you are an adult and dealing with teenagers, we do stop listening to them after some time. We don't do it consciously, we don't make a decision, I'm not going to listen. But that's how the whole conversation goes. And that is the reason why all teenagers feel that anybody who has crossed that threshold into 20 is an old fogey, gone, finished. After 20, it doesn't matter whether you are 21 or 91. According to them, you are all outdated anarchists and you belong to that Manjada or Rampa or something of that sort. You should be put in museums. And I'll tell you the reason why also. If you actually put a webcam in the house of, let's say, a family where there is a teenage boy, and the boy goes out to play, and he has been told that, you come back at 6:30 because you have to do a lot of homework or studies or whatever it is, so you finish your playing and come back at 6:30. Inevitably, the 6:30 becomes 6:40, 6:50, 7 o'clock, 7:10. 7:10, the child walks in. His father is sitting there waiting for him, literally to pounce on him. But the father is supposed to be part of family, part of home, which he loves to go back to. In fact, he may have had stresses during the day, he may have been scolded by a teacher, he may even have had an argument with a friend on the football field or cricket field or something, he's feeling a little out of sorts. Does he come back to a welcoming father who said, "Hey man, so nice to see you, dude, come sit down, relax. You want to have something to eat or drink and all that? It's already late, come, let's do something and then you have to get down to study." No, it doesn't start with that. In many cases, it starts with, "Oh, grandman, now you have come home. You remember you have a home also, isn't it? My memory is not that bad. That you may be having dementia, I don't have. I know where is my home. You leave me anywhere in the world, I'll come back to home." So where's the question of remembering? What a stupid statement to make. And what a question to ask. Do you want an answer? Do you remember that it's whom you're asking that question from? Do you even know what time it is? Dad, there's a huge clock right in front of you. You and your mobile is showing the time. Why are you asking me, do you know what time it is? And I also know what time it is. It is exactly 12 minutes past 7. You know it, I know it, the clock knows it, the mobile knows it. So is that a question to ask? Do you know what time it is? Are you even bothered? What we had said, yes, I am bothered about that. But before I could tell you that I am bothered, but on the way I had a cycle puncture or our game extended, or before I could give the reason, where were you? You know where I was. I had gone to play cricket or something of that sort, or I was in Rahul's house or something like that. I know where you were. Now, if you know where you were, why did you ask me that question? I know, that's stupid, all that, I know. Why do you get along with those Russian type of friends? You don't have better friends. Dad, Rahul's father tells him the same thing. Why do you get along with this guy? He's a Russian. All of you parents think the same thing. By the way, Dad, if you give me a chance, I can give you some nice comments about your friends. Some of them, I know what they are. That so-and-so uncle, you remember how in that party he had got drunk and the way he was behaving. Rahul never behaves that way. Rahul never gets drunk. You can afford to have a friend like that, but you point fingers at Rahul without knowing him. Now, why did I tell you this long story? To help you to understand that one basic point. That teenagers want you, request you, plead with you to please listen. Give me a chance to express what is going on in my mind. You can disagree with it. Later on you can say, no, I will not give you permission to stay late, even if the game goes on from tomorrow on afterwards, you have to come back at 6:30, we'll talk it over. But why does it, because I came 40 minutes late, why does it become such a huge and a convoluted thing? Now tomorrow, when everybody is sitting on the breakfast table, the teenager makes it a point not to come because he knows if he comes and sits on the breakfast table, dad will start off with some lecture to him. So he keeps away. And dad gets even more angry, shouts at the mother and says, well, look at your great fellow, he's still sleeping, he doesn't even come and have breakfast with us. He chooses not to have breakfast with you because you're not creating a happy environment. And that is the fundamental of what I want to share with you today, that there are so many ways and means by which we can live happily with teenagers. I can tell you, those of you who have teenagers at home or in the neighborhood or in the classroom or wherever it is, if you have this privilege of being able to interact with teenagers on a regular basis, you are blessed. There's nothing better than that. Of course, small children are very cute, you can cuddle around, you can lift them up, you can hug them. There are ways and means of enjoying with small children, but there's a limitation. When there is a teenager, and today's teenagers, one thing I can tell you is, they can teach us so much more. This set of teenagers of today in the 20th century, those who were born, you know, after the turn of the century, after 2080, these are people whom we are referring to as digital natives. Like somebody is a native of Coimbatore, somebody is a native of Malleshwaram, somebody is a native of Delhi. All these children are natives of the digital world. It's immaterial where they were born and where they grew up and what is their mother tongue and something of that sort. All their tongues are the tongue that is inside the mobile phone. So these people, as being natives, have an edge over us who are digital migrants. We grew up in a world where digital or not, their smartphones came only around 2005 or something of that sort, 15 years back. We, those of us who were born more than 50, 20 years back, have spent some time in this world without having a smartphone. That's the other thing this day look up to you extremely. You actually, you know, you lived in a world without a phone. What did you do with yourself? You know, how did you keep yourself occupied? What were your activities? What was life there? They don't understand what it is. So now that we have the privilege of having these digital natives around us, we can learn so much from them. Take a simple thing. If you get a new mobile handset or some such gadget, and it comes with a manual and this and that, you spend half a day on Sunday going through page by page, checking out these, you know, experimenting with that, pushing those buttons, and keep getting more and more confused. You call a teenager and give it to him, saying, can you just fiddle with this and tell me what are the features and how it works? And you said, this is the manual. He said, keep the manual, I don't need it. In 15 minutes, he'll come back and teach you everything that is there about that gadget or app or whatever it is. So when we know that there is so much that we can learn from them, why is it that we try to impose ourselves? Now this imposition started long back and was relevant till even one century back. And one generation back, when there was this very great word called experience. If somebody would say, I am an accountant, I am an engineer, I am a doctor, I am an architect, the first question that would be asked is, fine, you are qualified, but do you have experience? If you don't have experience, forget it. Today, if you say that you are a software engineer or a doctor or this or that, and somebody asks you, have you got experience? And if you say, yes, I have got 25 years experience, thank you, bye-bye, go, you are outdated. The guys who have learnt now know so much more than what you learnt. It's a fact. Whatever studies you have done, whatever you have studied in college, university, you may have gone in for higher qualifications also, it is completely outdated. So what is this thing called experience? Lifestyles are outdated. The outdating that took place from the turn of the century in the last 20 years, more than that, change in lifestyle came in the last 2 months. Now we are talking about the new normal. Now that is something that really makes me extremely agitated. What do you mean by new normal? Sitting at home is normal, is it? Putting on masks and going around is normal. Not being able to give a hug to your best friend is normal, is it? Why are we accepting things so easily and saying new normal? If you say this is the new abnormal, I'll agree with you. It's like saying that, you know, I was sick, so I was bedridden. So now lying on the bed whole day is new normal. No. When you are on bed because you are ill, every day you are waiting, the day I get all right and I get, I'm able to get up and walk out, that will be my normal life. I'm waiting for that whenever it happens. Somewhere along the line, they seem to have given up. And what are they doing with the teenagers today? There's a lot of talk about small children as it is, how we are dealing with them, what we are doing, all this online classes, they should have only half an hour, and they should have 3 hours, and all this. I've been coming across hilarious stories of these online classes that are going on, particularly for small children. This four-year-old, the father is told that you make her stand against a wall, and then you put the camera and ask her a question, and she has to reply to that question, and the teacher will know what she replied. So he goes and, you know, pampers his child and makes her stand over there. By the time he puts the camera up, she's gone. He goes running, catches her, brings her back and puts her there. By the time she's running away somewhere else. By the time he's asking something, then if he, you know, tries to be a little strict with her, she starts bawling. She's crying her head out. Now you have to pacify her, give her a chocolate, convince her, again make her. And then you ask that question and she says, no, I don't want to tell you the answer. I know the answer, but I don't want to tell you. You're a bad papa, I don't like you. That's what is going on in this. Okay. That is as far as all children is concerned. I am more concerned about teenagers. As I said, they are people who are already looking for an identity. One of the things which a lot of teenagers tell, I don't know whether you experience it, it's my life. I will do whatever I want. And adults get so angry. What you're like, what do you know about it? Stupid friends, you don't know anything. I have to tell you. I don't do that. When I'm interacting with a teenager, even if he does not tell it, I tell him. I tell him, it's your life. You have to decide about your life. First time somebody said that to him, yes, uncle, you're right, it's my life. But all you need to do is to learn how to have your own life and take your decisions. If somebody were to present a nice brand new bike, get it registered in your name and hand over the RC book and insurance and lifetime tax and petrol tank full, everything, you can say, it's my bike. But do you know how to ride it? You've not learned how to ride it, so what's the point in saying it's my bike? So first learn how to ride the bike. First learn what is life and then say it's my bike. Come, let's talk about it. You talk about it. That's the whole crux of the thing, as I've said. Listen to them. Encourage them to talk on any topic under the sun. By the time a child has come to adolescence, there should be no topic which the child feels hesitant. If I tell this to my mother or my auntie or my teacher, they will get angry. Huge barrier comes in. I can talk. They may not agree with what I'm saying, but I feel free to talk. And then you see the joys of interacting with the teenagers. They have such wonderful things to share. They have such a beautiful life going, which you and I can never get back, except reliving our lives in the see. Help them to identify emotions and talk about their emotions. If you can do that, it will be so wonderful. If you can make them talk about their emotions, what are you feeling now? What makes you happy? What makes you sad? What irritates you? Why do you like a particular person and why do you dislike a particular person? Give me reasons for it. The teenager will love you. Teenager will open up. It will do a great service to the teenager and to you both. That is what I want you to understand. These are such simple things that unless you experience it, you will not really understand the depth of it. You say, okay, what Ali said is fine. Yeah, I agree. Nothing new here. I knew all these things. So what has he got to say which I didn't know? A lot of things in our life we know, but we don't actually practice it. We don't convert it into reality. And that is what our education system does also, no? You learn some benzene rings or something in chemistry. You learn the capillary action of roots in biology. You learn something in algebra. You know that. But do you put it into actual life? No. So we have got used to certain things. And we are cognizant saying, I know what it is, but unless I can put it into practice. And that is what I would like you to do. Go back home today, even if you don't have a teenager at home, look for one somewhere around the place and say, hi, I want to make friends with you. He'll look at you very suspiciously and say, what's happening, you know, how come you're doing this? It will take time. But even that will be a great thing on your part. If you can break that barrier and say, I want to make friends with you because I want to learn something from you. Nobody has ever said that to the child. Everybody from parent to teacher to uncles and aunts and ajis and tatas, everybody tells them, I will tell you what to do. And that's where the whole thing stops. They have such wonderful things to say. Ready? Yeah, as I mentioned, there is this very spontaneous, quick little video clip, you know, from the teenagers. You just make them talk and they have something to say to you. Switch off these lights. That one also. Oh, this one. It's not a very rehearsed or a formal or something of the sort. It came out so spontaneously. It gives you an insight into what goes on in the mind of a teenager. And all it takes, how did we manage to get this? This girl just...
Okay, with my fingers and thoughts, don't check me out from here. My guest Ali asked me to explain things that I never heard you speak. My parents always ask me to explain things but never allow me to speak. We need to listen to us and respond and not react in judgment. Don't pass remarks on my friends, it upsets me a lot. Trust me, if I'm capable of things, I'm not that weak, jaded, and wild to think, but I'm not even a grown up when I just pretend. If we make mistakes, you can just correct us instead of shouting at us. We need to experience certain things to remember it, so let us do it. I need her to trust me. Arguments are an actual part of being a family, except mine. You wish that I knew so many things, but I wish that you were my role model.
As you saw, technology is more difficult to get going rather than teenagers. All we have to say is, hey guys, nobody will scold you, nobody will say anything to you. Whatever you have to say, just come in front of the camera, say it and move out. And that's what they have to say. So this is what it is all about. I will also request Punima to share a little bit of what the type of interaction that we have been having with teenagers all these years. And of course, our best teenager is sitting right at the back, that is Sonal, who I feel very jealous of because she spends all her time with children and teenagers while we have to sit with boring adults. And but we have had innumerable experiences. Today, we will share just one or two quickly with you just to get a concept or drive in the point of what I was saying. And then, as Seema told you, let's have an open house, let's have questions, let's have comments, whatever you feel like, you are open to it. You can write down on a piece of paper, and the others who are there online can send us your questions on the chat box. As soon as we complete this, we will start with the open notes. Over to you, Pranima.
Thank you, Ali. I'd like to share a small story. I'd like to share a small story with you all. There was this very big multi-storied apartment, and there was this person, the janitor, who also takes care of the lift and all the other maintenance and all. He comes on his cycle. So the security guy says, "I need to check what is there." He says, "Of course, please, Doda, no hazards." And then he finds that there are some used plates and things like that. He said, for 606 May, there was a office inauguration. So I'm carrying all the leftover food. He says, okay, good, go ahead. Then after 3-4 days, again he comes on his cycle. And then he's again carrying two big bags. So the security guy knows him well. He's there with him for around 10, 12, 13 years with him. He says, hey, I just need to do my duty. I need to check. What are you taking with you? He said, no, it's all the scrap material because the painting was happening. So the MD paper and all that I'm carrying with me. He says, yeah, but I need to do my duty. He says, sure, do that. And then again he checks, absolutely nothing. He goes away. Again after a month, this man comes on his cycle. And then again he has three big, bags full of all stuff. He says, you're lucky, yeah? So many people are giving you so many things. He says, no, that office have shifted from here and they have gone out somewhere else. So there was some balance, some wood and other things and all, scrap material. They have asked me to take this and go. So I just decided, okay, I might sell it and make some little money. He says, okay, let me check. Again, he, upturns the whole thing, checks it, and absolutely nothing goes away. Now, they both knew each other for nearly 10, 12, 13 years. So he says, I want to ask you something. He says, yes, what is it? He says, I know there is something fishy happening. He says, fishy? Why do you say that? He says, I'm sure that there is something fishy which you are doing whenever you are carrying these bags and going. So can you tell me that I'm your friend and we have known each other since so long? He says, okay, then let me tell you. He says, what are you stealing? What are you taking and going in those bags? He says, no, I'm stealing cycles and going. So, from our experience with all these lovely, wonderful teenagers, one experience that we have received is that please understand and differentiate the major from the minor. So quite often, if it is a major issue, we bring in all minors. And if it is a very minor issue, which could have just been sorted out like that, he's forgotten to keep his books on the rack. We say, I told you right from then, and your father also never interferes. And he's wondering, oh my God, I'm born in a family where I have a confused father and an irresponsible mother. It was such a simple thing which could have been told with respect, with dignity, and we could have sorted it out. And at the same time, if it is a very major issue, we bring in all the small minor things and say, you did this also. I know on that day you didn't keep the teacup. And then he takes the chance and says, okay, let me push this major with the help of all the minors. So if we have to move along well with teenagers, one thing which, as a message which I would like to share with my experiences is that please differentiate the major with the minor. Don't sweat the small stuff, but have all your major things addressed with proper negotiation, dealing and communication. Thank you. Over to Ali, and we are ready for the questions, clarifications. So Seema and I will be here. Please write down your questions. So Seema will be checking the questions which are coming up on the FB Live, and I'll quickly come along, take questions which you have on those small sheets of papers. Ali, over to you.
I saw a real life demo of what Purnima said just now. There was this mother who was very concerned that his son's exams are coming and he is not studying and he is all. So she decided that at sudden such time you have to come and sit here. I will sit with you and I will see that you study properly and all that. Okay, so this guy comes and sits down. Before he can open the book, the mother looks at him and he's got his hair sticking out like this. What is this, your hair? No, ma'am, that is called, what is it called, by the way?
Spike.
Spike. No, ma'am, this is spike. What do you mean spike? No, ma'am, this is the latest hairstyle. All my friends are doing this. Don't be stupid. How did you do this? And for the next 20 minutes, the discussion went on, bypassing a serious topic like he has got his exam and what he is studying to talk about the spike. And as she rightly said, the child got a very good opportunity to say, tell me what is wrong with that. Doesn't daddy have that friend who has got his hair going like this? You don't say anything to him. So what? Now we have a big, nice, long, half an hour discussion going on different hairstyles where the mother was trying to inspire the child into taking responsibility for his studies. So this is what we feel has to be looked into. The way we can bond and we can work as a team with the teenagers. They are no longer small children. They have a lot to teach us. So the same way as if I am in an office, if I am the accounts person and I have the sales person, we work as a team. We don't confront each other. We say, what is to do with sales? I'll take your suggestions. What is to be dealt with in accounts? You take my suggestions. We combine together and we form this team of what we are doing. That is how it goes. Yes, Simon.
Yes, Ali. So, I'll take the FB live questions now. And our live audience, please feel free to write. And we will address as many questions as possible till 12 o'clock. So, the first one is by Naveena Ali. She's saying, I have an 11-year-old son. And yesterday only I told him I want to learn PowerPoint from you. And he was so happy and happily said, I will teach you and we will do it together. It's really wonderful to talk to and learn with teenagers.
Fantastic, Naveena. Keep it up. This is a lesson for every mother, every adult. If you can do this. It's a genuine thing, no? I don't know PowerPoint. My kid knows PowerPoint. And significantly, if you notice, if this mother starts at 11 years of age, by the time he comes full-fledged into the teenage and adolescent, where he normally keeps away from his mother, he will be bonding beautifully with the mother.
Ali, the question is that how about peer influence on adolescents always may not be fruitful?
Definitely. No peer influence is always fruitful. Two things. One is, before you pass the buck on to somebody else, what is it that, Jesus Christ said, before you throw a stone at a sinner, those who have never committed a sin should be the first one to throw the stone, right? So we are talking about peer pressure. And mommy and daddy are sitting over the breakfast table and discussing, and dad says that, hey, my car is fantastic here. It's been giving wonderful service for the last 6 years. I'm sure at least another 6 years I can do it. But everybody in the lane seems to be having fancy cars and mine is so outdated and small car. So I'm getting this offer, where we get this exchange thing. I don't have to pay anything and stuff like that. So why don't we change the car? Mommy also said, yeah, I know. I also felt it, the other day Mrs. So-and-so was looking at our car like this. So I think we should also change. But that is not peer pressure. And the child is listening to you. The child is learning from you. That's one. The second thing I want you to understand is, while I agree that not all peer pressure is good, there is some peer pressure which is excellent. I have actually worked with teenagers who have not been able to do what they should be doing. They're not interested in studies or they're getting into bad habits or something. Whenever we have used their peers to talk to them about it, it works wonders. Just to give you a quick example, I stopped by at a friend's house and I saw that his teenage daughter, college-going daughter, was at home at 5 o'clock in the evening. So I was wondering, I'd never seen her in daylight. So I was just wondering, I said, why you're not feeling well or something, you're at home at 5 o'clock. Now until nowadays it starts raining in the evenings, and I have my scooty and it's dangerous with all these potholes and this and that. So I'm coming back before it gets dark. Wonderful. But how did this wisdom dawn on your no uncle, no Ritvik, no my classmate. He told me that at 6 o'clock I'll give you a call on your landline. I want to make sure that you are at home at 6 o'clock. Okay, very nice of Ritvik, he is doing this. But if I remember right, your mom also keeps saying every day that, you know, it is dangerous. Ma, she just likes to give caution. But Ritvik is genuinely interested in my welfare, no uncle. So when Ritvik says that, I can't let him down to a fellow. Now this is peer pressure. Positive peer pressure. Because, not because, you know, the Ritvik loves her more or the mom loves less. It is the way you are expressing it. When mother tells a child, you will be lying in some hospital somewhere, you will have an accident, stupid girl, why do you want to know, where do you want to go and why do you want to stay? Whereas Ritvik says, hey, don't do that, man, come on, please, you know, I get worried about you should not do it. The other day I heard of an accident or something of that sort. I don't want you to fall down and slip on the road or something. That's the way that the peer talk and the peer pressure can do wonders with teenagers. Use it.
And Ali, the next question is, no communication with friends, how does it affect teenagers, and about controlling screen time?
No communication with friends because of the lockdown.
Yes.
Yeah, that's true. But why are we so strictly making it no communication with friends? Teenagers are little grown up. Selectively, we can encourage them the same way selectively all of you have come over here. You're maintaining social distance, you want a sanitizer, you're wearing masks, you're taking whatever precautions are to it. If you still had to be struck with the virus, it could have happened at home also, so there's nothing great about it. So can we not teach them to selectively interact with friends? Face-to-face interaction means wonders which no amount of screen time can give you. And now please remember that we have come into a very, very dicey situation. Before the lockdown, we as adults or as teachers used to say, don't spend too much time on the screen, you will become an addict. So go to school, go to college, attend classes, do homework, go out and play, do outdoor games, do this, do that, but don't spend too much time on your mobile or laptop. Now it's reversed. Now we are telling them you have to sit and spend time on this, you have to attend so many classes and you have to do this sort of thing. So it is we who are creating this world and we who are confusing them. That is one important point I want you to keep in mind. Whenever you change rules, you may be doing it for the protection of the student, or whatever it is, I don't deny that to you. But do we take the trouble of explaining to them why you are doing it? For example, if you see this huge debate going on now, whether children should have online classes or not, we have almost, you know, very clearly decided that schools will not reopen in the near future. Fine, we are going to take that precaution. I respect the views both of the government and the parents. But what is the alternative? Is learning going to stop just because the child physically does not go to school? How do we take care of that? So they are talking about online, they are saying it should be half an hour, it should be 4 hours. I have a simple question to ask all these people. Did you take the opinion of at least a slight amount of children? Even younger children, I tell you, they have so much to say. In fact, right now I'm in that process. Degenerate has asked me to write an article. I discussed with them about the importance of taking the opinion, and right now I'm in the process of writing that article. Purely the viewpoint of the children about online classes. Now they feel warm that they, you know, there are adults who are willing to listen. You don't have to, you know, follow minutely what they said, but at least let's start with taking their opinion.
Right, Ali. Alice is saying, I remember when I had a class in Banjara on sex education. That's just gone, but basically she's saying that when I, you know, there was a class on sex education, I came home and told my son about it. And just a few months back, he was 12 years old at that time, just the other day, a few months back after that, he came and asked me if I knew about pornography. So, yeah, that is something that she's talking about.
Wonderful. Here's a wonderful example. Thanks, Alice, for sharing. Here's a wonderful example. When the mother talks openly to the child, saying that, you know, we had this class on sex education, what is its importance, at what age, what you should learn, and how are... We didn't have it, but we would like to impart it. So she has done that. What has she done? She has laid the foundation for a good communication between the son and the mother. So at a particular point, now the child is coming to the stage where probably he has some friends who are getting on more and more to pornography, and nobody talks about it. It is such a hush-hush thing. Now the child is getting confused. On the one side, probably there are one or two friends who are literally teasing him and saying, hey, you are a bacha man, you don't watch porn, is it? Ah, you are a stupid, silly fellow, we the big boys, we do this, this is a macho thing. On the other hand, he knows that if I get caught in the school or whatever it is, you know, I am going to be in trouble. He also knows that parents will get extremely angry if he doesn't. So where do I stand? Now, if this child, as he did, hats off to Alice, told mother, Ma, do you know what is pornography? So now he can take a class on sex education to his mother.
Ali, how do we gently say, I don't agree and approve with your actions, behavior with a 17-year-old?
You know this policy of what we call a sandwich policy? So you have two slices of bread and in between you can tuck in all the vegetables that you want and the pig won't know and he will eat it happily. So you start with a positive stroke. Start with an open discussion. Start with accepting whatever the child is saying on simple matters. Give a lot of positive strokes and praise the child. Then come to the point and say, this I don't agree. In fact, that is what Purnima had said between, you know, the major issues and the minor issues. When you are talking to your child about preparing for exams, you don't take the conversation to his hairstyle. However much you may disapprove of that hairstyle, there are time to discuss that separately. So you give this positive stroke, bring in quietly this issue. Be firm and say, this is not something that I agree with, or this is not something which I will allow you at this age or this stage of life. I don't think I am still in control over you. When you grow up, you can do whatever you want. But right now, I am not going to allow you. I am very firm on that. Then take the topic back to something positive, the other side of this sandwich. What you can do is this. Now that you are a little grown up, I don't mind if you, you know, take your cycle and roam around, you know, within this area or something of that sort. End it up on a positive note.
Yes, Ali. Archana is saying that we deal with authority with teenagers. Instead, if we treat them with respect, they will be more open to talk with us.
100% I agree with you, Archana. It's a general policy with anybody, but more so with teenagers. Give respect and get respect. I remember the time when somebody in a seminar had asked a teenager, why is it that you youngsters don't give respect to your elders? And there was this real handsome, sweet teenager who looked straight in the eyes of that gentleman, gave a very nice, simple smile and said, sir, I don't see any reason why I should respect somebody just because incidentally he was born before me. Earn respect. It's not that difficult.
Ali, can we accept the decision taken by the teenager? Is the age of teenager a confusion stage to take decision? Is the age of teenager dangerous?
Dangerous. Yeah, it is dangerous to the teenager because the adults keep messing up their life. To that extent, it is dangerous. But otherwise, as I said, it is definitely not dangerous. Yes, I agree. As I told you, no, teenagers will say, it's my life, I'll do what I want. And there are doubts I have that, no, he doesn't know what to do with his life. So we need to look into the thing and understand the thing. So then there are areas where you can trust him. I told you, you want to know something about a mobile phone, he'll teach you what it is, some software, some apps, something to do with electronics or something. He'll probably be able to teach you more. There will be areas where perhaps he does not understand. Supposing, you know, the type of company that he keeps, he's got some friends who are into some smoking or some bad habits, and he feels attracted to them, and he's not able to take that decision. Do not do policing, do not crush them or, you know, try to discipline them. Help them to come out with it. Why do you think, you know, your friend Suresh smokes cigarettes? What's the advantage of smoking cigarettes? What do you get out of it? He will be forced to think, introspect, and come out with certain answers about what is right and what is wrong. If you create a debate on that, and at some point, if he himself comes out with this awareness that he is smoking cigarettes, it's a stupid thing to do. What are you really getting out of it? And just because Suresh and Ramesh are smoking cigarettes, okay, they are my friends, I can't stop them. But I don't necessarily have to smoke. So when they tell me you smoke, you say, hey, I tried it out. I don't like it. I don't like that smell and that taste of cigarettes. So be done with it. I'm not going to. So you guys go ahead and light up. I'm not going to join you. These are skills to check.
Ali, Poonam is saying that she has twins, a boy and a girl, studying in 10th standard. My son doesn't speak much to his friends, unlike my daughter. Is it okay or I need to help him with that?
Yeah. First thing, when you're dealing with a child, more so a teenager, never compare. So you have two children. Don't start saying, she does this but he doesn't do that. He does this and she doesn't do that. You have two children, separate them out when you're dealing with them. Focus on your son, let us say. And talk about the issues that your son has. Now, what is the issue? He's not a very social guy. He doesn't talk to too many people. All you need to do is to understand whether temperamentally he's like that. He's happy having one or two friends. He comes back home and communicates everything under the sun to his parents and family members. And he doesn't feel the need to socialize or go to parties or make new friends. So be it. Regardless of any sibling or anybody else having different behavior patterns. But if he's scared, if he's shy, the moment he sees people, he starts, you know, getting restless or getting upset or something. Yes, then we need to do something about it. How we go about it, I will not explain now, but there are ways and means of doing it. And as we always keep reminding you people and telling you, if there are any specific issues where you feel, you know, that this has to be corrected, I've tried my best, but somewhere I'm getting stuck and all that, please feel free to get in touch with us. I repeat again that we provide free counseling in person, on phone, and through email, whichever means is suitable to you. So individual issues like this we can deal. But golden rule, never compare.
How can we motivate children without being materialistic?
First, we have to stop being materialistic. I gave you the example of the, you know, father who says that I want to buy a new car just because my neighbors have good cars and I have an old car or something of that sort. So if you practice what you preach, 50% of your job is done. Second part of it is when they, despite that, I want you to know and accept that teenager, that stage of life is such, they would like to be materialistic. They would like to have the high-end phone, they'd like to have a good bike, they'd like to have this or, you know, expensive branded shirts or whatever it is. It's natural, they're going through that phase. Instead of suppressing them or anything of that sort, ask them, why is it necessary? What is it? You can buy a sports shoe for 2,000 rupees, you can get a Nike shoe for 8,000 rupees. He insists that, no, I want a Nike shoe. I'm open to considering it. Justify it. Tell me, what is the difference? Have you been able to find out? Go and check out with a friend who's got a branded shoe and check out with a friend who's got an ordinary shoe. If possible, if they're the same size, wear them and see the difference. If you can convince me and if I can afford it, I will definitely buy it for you. But first, you have to be convinced, then you come back and convince me.
Ali, I have a son, 15 years, and a daughter, 17 years. Both are good in academics, but the son is also a little naughty. So the teachers always compare them, and my son has grown up saying that how much ever I do, they will like only the system. So what do I do to bring him down back to academics?
Hearty congratulations for having a naughty teenager at home. I would prefer a teenager to be naughty rather than to be very gloomy and sitting in one corner. That's not the age when a child should be so withdrawn and this and that. Second point again came out, what is it to do with the sister? Why are we talking about the sister when your issue is with your son? You want something to be done about the son, don't bring the daughter into the picture. Then make him talk. Which are the teachers? Every one of us, whether we are adults or teenagers, we tend to generalize. So he makes a statement saying that, you know, the teachers only like my sister, they don't like me. How many teachers you interact with on a regular basis? Out of that, how many are there who keep telling you your sister is good and you are not good or something? Inevitably, you will find that if he is dealing with 10 teachers, only 2 are doing that. The other 8 teachers respect him for whatever it is. They are nice, they are balanced people, they are not partial. But he gets so carried away by these two that he generalizes and says, teachers don't do it. Help him to understand that. Everywhere you will be meeting people who have certain biases, who do not accept you for what you ignore them. Move on. If they are open to it, explain to them why and what about it. If not, we will, you know, move on with that. You will accept it. I know that you have certain capabilities which are unique, for which I regard you and I love you. It's got nothing to do with anybody, whether it's your sister or anybody else in the whole world. I want you to have that confidence, that self-esteem, and move on the way you want. I think we'll take the last two questions.
Yeah, this series, so maybe together you could help us out with it. We also see teenagers delete messages before they enter home. Teenagers create havoc, and mother and father not knowing anything. Can we allow a teenager to shout at home? We also hear, I have more of girlfriends, less of boys. Very often we hear teenagers say, I want to commit suicide. What do we do to control teenagers' addiction to mobile? What is the precaution to be taken when you speak to a teenager?
Oh, I'm overwhelmed. I take one serious matter. If a teenager mentions that I want to commit suicide, take it seriously. He may not actually commit suicide, but the very fact that he has made such a statement means what he is trying to convey is, I'm feeling isolated from the whole world. I'm feeling very lonely. I'm feeling that nobody cares for me. And that can play havoc with the life of a child. He may never commit suicide. He may live for another 80 years, but his quality of life is going to go down. So never ignore. Make him talk about it. What made you even think of such a thing? I want to know. I accept it. When you say that, I respect that. You will not be saying it just to, you know, thrill me or scandalize or something of that sort. I know that you must be genuinely getting these sort of thoughts. Why are these thoughts coming? How can we overcome? So each one of these issues, you need to go back to what I told you, make them talk as much as possible. Let them bring out their emotions. Ask them what are the possible solutions. If I am allowed to do that, then I will feel better. If I can do that, that girlfriend of mine dissed me and went away, that is why I am feeling suicidal. Okay, I acknowledge it. You genuinely love that girl, you wanted to have her as a partner, and you felt so, you know, you are building up so much hopes. But for whatever reason, she had left and gone away. Now can we talk about, like, can we also understand what must have happened, so that next time when you are looking for a partner in life and as you grow up and things of that sort, you will be much more mature. Let's use it as a learning exercise to understand girls and to understand how a good boy-girl relationship, is formed. That is the teamwork which I keep, talking about. Do I allow my child to shout in the house? Yes. As long as you don't shout louder than him or her, don't make it a shouting match. The moment the child shouts, don't shout louder and say, shut up, who are you, what are you? No. Look at him and smile at him and say, wow, what a strong voice you've got. Even the neighbors are hearing. But I think I'm not deaf so far. So if you tell me the same thing softly also, I'll be able to understand. But I know, right now you're very agitated. Acknowledge his emotion. Can we do something? Take 5 minutes off. I'll go and wash my face and I'll go and stand in the balcony and all that before I react. And come, we'll sit down. We'll maybe make a cup of tea or make some juice or something. We'll sit down and we'll talk. That is all. Keeps coming back to the same point every time.
One last question which I don't know if I ask, but it's very interesting. How can we motivate children without being materialistic? So maybe a lot of last questions I thought.
Yeah, and that's what I said about materialistic thing. Am I materialistic? I already dealt with that, saying that. Am I being materialistic? Please remember that. Don't you realize how much the child picks up from the elders? So if I say that, yes, I've got enough money to buy a 3 BHK apartment, but I'm going to buy only the most prestigious condominium where, the higher society people are there or something of that sort. I may think that I'm being ambitious and I'm providing a good thing, but it is materialistic. Anything of that sort, right down to the smallest of things. And then, as I told you, despite that, if the child says that I want this, I gave you the example of branded shoes or something of that sort. Talk it over and make them come out with it. That's how it goes. It's an ongoing thing. And please understand that It's not a one-time thing or there are no hard and fast rules, but we have to keep on building up on this. It's not very difficult, provided you take up the attitude that I am going to live happily and to enjoy with my children. So to bring you down to adolescence or maybe even lower than that, all those of you who came here personally and took that step forward, because I'm really encouraging, I'm really feeling very proud of those of you who are breaking the barriers and stepping out. So here we have a quick little gift for each one of you, which we cannot put through the internet and through Facebook and give it to those who are on the Facebook, it's upside down.
It's upside down. With the mask, you can't even see me smiling.
Thank you for coming. Thank you.
So that is a quick little gift to all of you. I wind up again by reminding you that we are there. We are this weekly session. You're most welcome every Saturday, 11 to 12. We are doing this Facebook live and into that sort. We are also continuing with our third Thursday lectures, which are again, face to face over here. So this time the third Thursday lecture is on what topic? Can you read it from there? My memory is poor. Further down. Third Thursday lecture this month. Date and topic.
Help yourself by helping others.
Date.
16 July,
10 to 11, not 11 to 12. Our third Thursday lecture is always 10 to 11. So 16th July, Thursday, help yourself by helping others. And then we continue with our Saturday talks. And over to Seema.
Thank you so much for coming. And thank you to our live audience. And the next Saturday's topic is going to be changing your career any time in your life, at any point of time. So that is also something which a lot of people have been introspecting about. And coming back to our topic, and by the way, this board has been done by my colleague Meera, and she's also a counselor here. And behind the camera, we have Sunita, another counselor of mine. We are all batchmates, so we've all done it together. I'm the program coordinator. My name is Seema. So that's about the team. Of course, thank you, Ali and Purnima, our director, and the go-to person for. She's so sweet and helpful every time we are, we need her. She's
always. Oh, I have to smile.
And one more last thing, those of you who have come, Venu is there to give you what? Venu, what are you giving us?
Cool drinks and biscuits,
which also cannot be fed through Facebook. So those who didn't come are missing out on the smiley badge, on the cool drink, and on the biscuits, which cannot be compensated by any technology, anything. A nice drink is a nice drink, a biscuit is a biscuit, and a smiley is always a smiley. Even as you rightly said, with a mask on, you can see the smile in the eyes.
Right, and just to get back to the topic, we have a lot of booklets and books written by Dr. Ali, and you can, it's there in our office, available, really handy tips on different aspects, and this one is on teenagers. Similarly, we have many such books and booklets written by Dr. Ali, so you can take a look at that. And thank you so much, our live audience. So we will meet you again on Saturday with a new topic. So thank you for continuously coming in the last 2 months. I think every Saturday you all have attended. So I thank you all so much. Bye, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for
coming. Thank you so much.
All right. Anybody who wants to, buy, purchase this book, can please go ahead. Anis will be taking it around. So please feel free to buy. It's so nice to see you all. Actually, we are missing this classroom, the Allah Gulla, the activities so much.
know, there's so much giggling, laughter, and of course some of you are our new DCS students for the next batch. So we all sit here in between two classes sometimes, you know, we have a lot of potluck and that's where we all sit and have fun. And in between the classes, the chai wala who will come and sit, you know, between the 10:30 to 12:30 class, 11:30, so we all gather there, have our chai. It's a lot of fun. So these are not going to be those lectures for those of you who have enrolled with us. It's not going to be a lecture method and all that. Today, of course, we took slips from you because, you know, you will not be audible for our live show.